Hey folks, welcome to Digimento Education. This is Analog Electronics and Circuits Lecture 14. I am your course instructor, Utkarsh Upadhyay. Hopefully you are all doing good and are strong and are comfortable with all the concepts that I covered in from Lecture 1 to Lecture 13. If you haven't gone through all those lectures before, I would suggest you to go through them first and then hop on to this lecture 14. Otherwise, it would be very difficult for you to understand or grasp or get engrossed into the concepts that I am going to cover in this lecture 14 and the subsequent lectures. So, if you are well versed with all those concepts and try to solve as many questions as you can. So that would help you a lot in preparing for the GATE examinations. Okay, get the big examinations like GATE and IES and other PSU examinations. If you really like the video, please hit the like button, share and subscribe to our channel and write down your comments below in the comment section. And do suggest these videos to your friends who are in need of good lectures. Please do that. Please help others. So, we terminated our last lecture with some solved examples on clippers. And we saw some really good examples based on the clippers. I told you how to solve the questions which basically involved dealing with the diodes, first by performing open circuit analysis or short circuit analysis and carrying the analysis further and getting to the conclusion. So in this lecture, I'm going to start with some more examples based on clippers. Okay, let's begin this lecture. Okay, now let's have a look at the first example. In the circuit shown below, diodes are ideal and input voltages is varied linearly from 0 to 150 volt. Plot the transfer functions, transfer characteristics. So both the diodes D1 and D2 are ideal as mentioned in the question itself. So how do we proceed to the conclusion? Okay, how do we proceed? How do we start? How do we initiate our analysis? As I already told you in the last lecture, how do we do that? You should know that. We first perform the open circuit analysis. So first step, let both the diodes be off initially. Let D1 and D2 be off initially. Okay, so how would the circuit look like? It's going to look something like this. We are considering both the diodes to be off initially. This is VI. This is also off. This is open circuit. This is 25 volt. This is 100 volt. And this is VO. Okay. Now, the potential. So, what your VO would be? So, in this first case, let diode D1 and D2 be off initially, then VO will be equal to, let's say this particular voltage is VX, okay? Let's say this particular voltage is VX, okay? And this is, let's say, so VO will be equal to 25 volt because no current will flow across, flow through this branch. This is 200K, okay? And VX will be equal to VI in this case because nothing is flowing in here. This is 100K, okay? Now, in the first case, this is VX. Now we are increasing VI. Okay, if VI, now we are talking about this particular node because VX is equal to VI. If VI is less than 25 volt, let's say VI is less than 25 volt, then this diode D2 will be reverse biased. D2 is reverse biased, and then output voltage will remain at 25 volt. Understand? Now B, if VI becomes greater than 25 volt, we are not considering 100 volt here because of course 25 volt falls much behind 100 volt. So as we are progressively increasing, as we are basically progressively increasing, gradually increasing your VI to greater voltage values, so 100 volt will fall after 25 volt has already arrived. Okay, so when VI is greater than 25 volt and if VI is less than 50, so in this case, so your D2 will become on, D2 is on and D1 is off. So here, let's say we are considering VI is less than 100 volt. Okay, so D1 is off. In that case, what would happen? Your circuit would look something like this. This is 100k, this will remain off. This is basically 100 volt. This is VI. This diode will be short circuited now. This is 200k, this is 25 volt. And this is the output voltage VO. Understand? Now, what your voltage would be here? Okay, we need to find out the VX voltage. VO will no doubt remain at 25 volt, and your VX will be equal to, since we are now we are going to apply a voltage divider here. This will be equal to VI into 200k plus 25 into 100k divided by 100k plus 200k. If you solve this, you get VX is equal to VO, because in this case VOX will be equal to VO, will be equal to 2VI plus 25 plus divided by 3. So this is your net output voltage. This is going to be your output voltage. Okay, now in this case, let's not consider this case first, because we are basically encountering this particular expression. This will decide the range of VI that would make D1 diode turn off or on. That would decide the current position, the current situation of the diode D1. Okay, now from here, here the case arises. If VX is less than 100 volt, now this particular voltage, if, because after your VX, when your input voltage becomes greater than 25 volt, this diode with diode D2 will be short circuited, then we have a voltage VX appearing across this the series combination of 200k and 25 volt as 2VI plus 25/3. Okay, now if VX is less than 100 volt, that is 2VI plus 25 divided by 3 is less than 100, which implies VI being less than 137.5 volt. Then your diode D1 will remain off. Okay, so if VI is greater than 25 volt and less than 137.5 volt, then D2 is on and D1 is off. And in that case, your output voltage VO will be equal to VX, which is equal to 2VI plus 25 divided by 3. This is one thing to keep in mind. Let's move on to the third case, when VI becomes greater than 137.5 volt. When VI becomes greater than 137.5 volt, then your diode D1 is on as well as your D2 is on. So both the diodes are on in this case. Okay, so the net circuit would look something like this. This is 100k, and this diode will be short circuited. This will be 100 volt. This is 100 volt. This diode D2 will be short circuited. This is 200k. This is 25 volt. And this is the output voltage. And this is your VI. So what will your output voltage be? We will basically see that. So output voltage is nothing but 100 volt, because 100 volt is in parallel with this series combination, and directly this particular voltage will appear at the output. So if we draw the transfer characteristics of this particular circuit, this is VO by VI. So we will mark this as 25 volt, this is 137.5 volt, and this is 25, and this is 100 volt. So when VI is less than 25 volt, your output voltage was equal to, let's draw it with the red color so that it basically increases the credibility of what I'm teaching. Okay, it will be, the output will be clamped to 25 volt. And when VI is greater than 25 volt and less than 137.5, we have VO is equal to 2VI plus 25 by 3. So it's a linear variation. So we will do it up to this particular point. Okay, it's going to be a linear variation like this. And after that, it will be clamped to 100 volts. Okay, so this is basically the representation. This is basically the output characteristic curve, transfer characteristic curve of this particular circuit. So this is VO is equal to 2VI plus 25 divided by 3. This is VO is equal to 100. This is VO is equal to 25. Understand? Let's solve one more question based on this concept. Let's have a look at the next question. In the circuit shown, diodes are ideal and input is varied linearly from 0 to 150 volt. Plot the transfer characteristics. This is the circuit and you have to plot the transfer characteristics of this particular circuit. I am leaving this question as an exercise to you. Please do this exercise on yourself by yourself. Based on so whatever I have covered, whatever basically I have discussed so far about the clippers, you have to follow the same procedure for solving each and every question related to clippers, related to diodes. You have to play with the diodes in the same manner I played in the last few examples. Okay, so let me just tell you what's your let me just write the answer where. So output will basically vary from 50 volt to 100 volt with a corresponding input variation from 50 volt to 100 volt. So I have already told you the answer. Try to solve it all by yourself and verify this thing. Okay, let's move on to the next topic of discussion, is the series clipper. So far we have discussed about the shunt clipper. Now let's discuss about the series clipper. Okay, series clipper, as the name, from the name, it's quite tacit that the diode is basically connected in series with the rest of the circuit. So series clipper circuit looks something like this. It is quite simple. Clipper questions are simple, but it all requires your diligence and hard work to solve these and practice. So this is a diode D, this is a resistor R, let's say this is R, this is some reference voltage VR, okay, this is input voltage VI, and the output is taken across this combination. Okay, now let's write down some cases that would help us solve the circuit. Okay, let's use the blue color pen. So if we are going to perform the open circuit analysis again, the diode is considered off initially, and if VI is greater than VR, if VI is greater than VR, this diode D2 will be on. This diode is forward biased and is on. Your output voltage will be equal to VI. Okay, now if VI is less than VR, your diode is reverse biased, which means that it is off, and output voltage will be equal to VR. Okay, so basically it's performing the negative clipping our circuit performs negative clipping. Why? Because if VI is less than VR, it basically, the output is clipped to VR. Okay, the output is the input, which is the input voltages, all those values which are less than VR reference voltage are clipped. Okay, and only the voltages above VR prevail, or you can say it's perform the negative clipping or bottom clipping. You can say it's bottom clipping, that is removes that part of the input signal that part of the input signal that lies below the reference voltage VR. So in order to perform the positive clipping, for positive clipping, diode orientation should be reversed. Okay, so this is how it goes. Let me just quickly solve an example based on this concept. Have a look at this example. In the circuit shown, diode has forward resistance of 100 ohm and otherwise it is ideal. Plot the transfer characteristics. It's quite simple. Let's perform the open circuit analysis first. And if we consider first case, if VI greater than 4 volt, if VI is greater than 4 volt, your diode is forward biased and on. So how do we represent this? So far we have been considering the diode to be ideal, and we basically considered the diode to be short circuit when it is forward biased and open circuit when it is reverse biased. But in this case, we are given the forward resistance of the diode. So when it is forward biased, we are not going to represent it with a short circuit. We will represent it with a resistance, which is 100 ohm or 0.1 kilo ohm. This will be your 4 volt, and output voltage VO will appear across this across the combination of these two. So this is 10k, this is 0.1k. We can write it as 0.1k. So the voltage that will appear here will be equal to VI into 0.1 plus 4 into 10 divided by 10 plus 0.1, which is 10.1, and it comes out to be 0.1 VI plus 40 divided by 10.1. Okay, now second case, if VI is less than 4 volt, your diode will be reverse biased. Diode is reverse biased and it is equivalent to an open circuit, because it is already mentioned in the question that when it is reverse biased, it will act as an ideal diode. So we are not going to consider any resistance that will appear across it when it is reverse biased. So this net circuit would look something like this. Okay, it will look something like this. This is VI and this is some resistance which is 10k, and this is the output voltage VO. So since there is no current, so VO will be equal to VI. VO will basically trace VI. So if we draw the transfer characteristics of the diode, the voltage transfer characteristics, so we mark 4 volt here and 4 volt here. So when VI is less than 4 volt, it will follow VI. This means that it will be a curve, it will be a straight line that will basically pass through origin. It will be something like this. This is VO, V will be equal to VI. And after that, it will be clamped to 4 volt. So VO will be equal to 4 volt. Here you can see. So, that's a mistake. I apologize for this particular mistake. Don't do that. It's not 4 volt. We already saw it's going to be a linear curve. We already saw that it's going to be a linear curve. It's 0.1 VI plus 40 divided by 10.1. So it will be somewhat equal to this. So this will be the output curve, and the slope of this thing will be equal to RF divided by RF plus R. This is 0.1 divided by 10.1. So it's going to be like this. Okay. Now we are done with the clippers. Hopefully you are now feeling comfortable with the clippers, with all the concepts related to clippers. Okay, I would suggest you to please go through the concepts once again and try to solve as many questions on clippers, because this topic is very pet to IIT people sitting there and preparing the gate examination, designing the gate examination paper. So you can expect a hell lot of questions asked from this particular topic. This is very important concept. This is very important topic that you must be well versed with. Okay, now we are starting with the clampers. We are now going to start another topic, another wave shaping circuit which are known as clampers. Okay, this is also important. Clampers, as the name implicitly suggests, that we are basically clamping the input to a certain potential value, to a certain potential value. Okay, we are clamping the input voltage signal to a certain voltage level. Okay, that's what is referred to as a clamper. That's, and it is what it does. Okay, it's quite tacit from the name itself that it clamps the input signal voltage. Okay, so it's a circuit. Let's write the some basic definitions. It's a circuit which adds a DC voltage to an AC waveform. Okay, a clamper, it's important to note down that a clamper does not change the shape of the input signal. It only shifts the signal either in upward direction or downward direction. Okay, clamper is used to restore or reinsert the DC component and component of a signal which has lost its DC during electronic processing. Some circuits may lose its DC component, which is very important part of the signal due to some electronic processing, and it is so this clamper circuit is basically used to restore the DC component that the AC signal would have possibly lost in the prior electronic processing. Okay, so clamper is also called as DC restorer or DC reinserter. Okay, there are some analogies, analogous terms. There are some synonyms of the clamper, DC restorer and or DC inserter. So we pass a weak AC signal to an amplifier. This is amplifier, and this is basically a weak AC signal. This is basically amplified AC. We pass it through a clamper that restores the DC component in the amplified AC signal, which does not have any DC component. So this is basically will be your amplified AC signal with DC. Okay, so we have two types of clampers. First one is a negative clamper. The another one is a positive clamper. Negative clamper and the positive clamper, it adds negative DC voltage, and this adds positive DC voltage. Let's discuss one by one. First, let's discuss the negative clamper. Okay, negative clamper will basically clamp will basically add a negative DC component in the input AC signal. That's quite tacit from the name. So its circuit looks something like this. We have a capacitor here, and negative clamper, keenly observe the diode orientation in the negative clamper. Okay, positive side is up and the negative sign is down. This is the capacitor, and the output voltage is taken across it, across the diode. This is a negative clamper, will basically add a negative DC component to the input AC signal. This is your input AC signal, and this is your output value. So by default, let's say for example purpose, I am taking input voltage to be a periodic square pulse, whose values are ranging from plus minus Vm to plus Vm. Let Vi be a plus minus Vm square pulse, a periodic one. Okay, we are considering that because it's an AC signal. Okay, that's basically an ideal clamper. Okay, so let's say this is the input AC signal. Let's just represent that with this is Vi, this is T. So it's basically varying from minus Vm to plus Vm. Okay, your input signal is somewhat like this. Now this is plus Vm, this is minus Vm. Okay, let me use another color to, let's say this is a capacitor C. Let's use another color to denote the output. Okay, now when Vi is plus Vm, your diode, the diode will be forward biased, and input voltage will basically charge the capacitor through this diode. Remember, this diode we are considering here is ideal. Here we are considering the diode to be ideal. So which means that there will not be any discharging path available for the capacitor to discharge through. Okay. So the capacitor, once the capacitor has attained a constant value, it will remain for the whole duration. It's not going to change. So capacitor will basically charge through this this thing. So we can say that output voltage, let's say this is plus minus VC. So output voltage will be equal to Vi minus VC. Okay, so this capacitor will, input voltage will charge the capacitor through diode D. So, and this would have happened a long time ago. So output voltage will nothing but will be equal to Vi minus Vm. The capacitor will basically charge the maximum value of Vm. Since there is no discharging path, the value Vm will not change. It will remain constant. Okay. So when Vi is plus Vm, when Vi is plus Vm, your output voltage will be equal to Vm minus Vm is equal to zero. Okay, let me just write leftward. So when Vi is plus Vm, your output voltage Vo will be equal to Vm minus Vm, which will be equal to 0 volt. Okay, now when Vi is equal to minus Vm, Vo will be equal to minus Vm minus Vm, this is minus 2 Vm. So as you can see here, the input voltage is clamped to 0 volt. So you can see the positive part of the square pulse is clamped to 0 volt, and negative part of the this thing is clamped to minus 2 Vm. This is minus 2 Vm. So the output would look something like this. So this is basically the output. Since the capacitor is not able to discharge, as there is no discharging path available in the circuit, since the diode is ideal and no external resistor is connected in the circuit, so the capacitor voltage will remain constant, and the output voltage, this is basically your output voltage. So this is basically your Vi, this is the output voltage. There's a steady state value. So this is basically a steady state output. Okay, if we would consider and this would basically, let's say T is equal to 0. Okay, let me quickly write some points related to this so that succinct. Okay, so during the positive cycle, diode conducts and capacitor charges through it. Okay, if diode is ideal, the capacitor charges up to the peak input Vm. Okay, during negative cycle, diode becomes off and capacitor cannot discharge, thereby capacitor voltage remains Vm. Okay, so Vo will be equal to Vi minus Vc by from KVL, and here you can see Vo will remain Vi minus Vm as we just saw. So when your Vi is Vm, output voltage will be 0, and minus Vm, it will be minus 2 Vm. Okay, let me write a note here. If the diode is not non-ideal, that is, has some cut-in voltage, then let's do the analysis. Consider this circuit, and here consider that the diode is non-ideal. So the equivalent representation of the diode will be an ideal diode with a series combination of an ideal diode and a cut-in voltage. This is a capacitor C, and this is an ideal diode, and this is a cut-in voltage of the diode. This is Vi, this is a capacitor C, this is ideal diode. Ideal diode, and this is your cut-in voltage, or the knee voltage, and this is the output. So let's do the analysis. Okay, your output voltage will nothing but be equal to this. Is, let's say this is plus minus Vc. So again we can see in the circuit that there is no discharging path available for the capacitor to discharge through. So once the capacitor has attained some particular voltage value, it will remain as such. It's not going to change. It's not going to deviate from that. So output voltage, if we apply the KVL, will be equal to Vi minus Vc in general. Okay, this is how it goes. But as we apply the KVL in the circuit, let's apply the KVL in the circuit. What do we get? We get minus Vi plus Vc minus Vi plus Vc minus V gamma. So when the diode is forward biased, this diode, ideal diode, will act as a short circuit. Okay, so when it will be equal to minus Vi plus Vc plus V gamma is equal to 0, your Vc will be equal to Vi minus V gamma. Understand? Okay, and the maximum value that the capacitor attains, and the voltage, and the constant voltage that the capacitor attains, will be when Vi is plus Vm. So this will be equal to Vi minus V gamma. This is a constant voltage that your capacitor attains, and it will not deviate from this particular voltage. Okay, so the capacitor voltage will be equal to Vm minus V gamma it will not be able to discharge as a no discharging path is available for the capacitor to discharge through. Okay, so your output voltage will be equal to Vi minus Vc. What is Vc? It's minus Vm minus V gamma. This will be equal to, this will be equal to, or you can write it as, let's write it in general. So this will be equal to Vi. This will be equal to Vi minus Vi. So your output voltage, so it will be Vc will be equal to Vm minus V gamma. Your output voltage will be equal to Vi minus Vm minus V gamma. This is equal to Vi minus Vm plus V gamma. So this is basically your output voltage. Okay, let's write the cases. So now, if Vi is equal to plus Vm, now if Vi is equal to plus Vm, your output voltage will be equal to Vm minus Vm plus V gamma. This will be equal to plus V gamma. If Vi is equal to minus Vm, your output voltage will be equal to minus Vm plus V gamma. This will be minus 2Vm plus V gamma. So this, so the your output would look something like this now. Let's say this is basically your output voltage. This is Vi, input voltage T, and it's something like this. This is square pulse. We are again considering a square pulse. Okay. This is plus Vm. This is minus Vm. Let's draw it with a red color. Okay. So let's say this is this particular voltage is plus V gamma. This is V gamma. So this output voltage, when it is with, so the positive part of the signal will be clamped to V gamma. And let's say this is minus 2Vm plus V gamma. So your output will, the lower, the negative part of the signal will be clamped to minus 2Vm plus V gamma. So the output is basically going to look something like this. Okay, so this is the output voltage representation. This is basically your output. It's a steady state representation. It's in the steady state. So positive part gets clamped to plus V gamma. It's quite tacit from the curve itself. Okay, so let's write down the summary from what we can conclude from all this analysis. A negative clamper is also called as positive peak clamper. Okay, it's an analogous term which is used interchangeably with a negative clamper. So a negative clamper is also called as positive peak clamper. Okay, and note down that an ideal clamper, capacitor does not has any discharging path, does not have a discharge path, therefore capacitor voltage cannot decrease when peak input is reduced. Okay, hence a discharge path has to be introduced to provide a discharge path in parallel to the diode of large value, okay, which is known as a practical clamper. That clamper is called as a practical clamper, otherwise it is called as an ideal clamper. So your practical clamper looks something like this. So we have a capacitor here, and this is basically a diode. This is input voltage VI, this is C, and there is a resistor of very large value connected in parallel with the diode, and this is basically your output voltage VO. So this is basically a practical clamper. RC time constant is very greater than T naught. Let's say T naught is basically the time period of the input square pulse. So R needs to be large so that the capacitor does not decrease considerably when diode is off. Okay, so for proper operation, RC should be greater than, so for propers for which RC needs to be greater than, very greater than T naught. Okay, so if we just have a look at the output signal variation corresponding to the input signal variation, let's say this is VI versus T, and this is basically your square pulse, which looks something like this. Okay, let's say this is basically an input square input variation. Let's draw the output wave variation. Let's have a look at that. So since we are not considering this, since we are considering the ideal to be diode to be ideal, so the positive part of which will be clamped to. So in this case, your initial voltages will VO will be equal to VI minus VM, because the capacitor will basically charge up to plus minus VM. Okay, the capacitor will charge to plus minus VM. So when VI is basically plus VM, your output voltage will be equal to zero. So it will look something like this. Okay, and when V input is basically minus VM, so your output voltage would look, this will be, let's say, minus 2 VM. Your output voltage will be equal to minus 2 VM for a particular instant. For this particular instant, this will be equal to minus 2 VM. And after that, you can see that when it is reverse bias, and the diode is reverse bias, the capacitor will discharge through the resistor R. So there will be a certain deviation from the steady state value, which is minus 2 VM. So the curve would look something like this. There will be a deviation like this from minus 2 VM, and when VI, so it will basically occupy some it will basically acquire some voltage. The capacitor voltage has now decreased to a certain value, and when VI again becomes plus VM, it will not be exactly zero, because your output voltage would be, let's say, then will be equal to VI minus some certain voltage, let's say V gamma. V gamma is not the cut-in voltage, remember. So when it is plus VM, it will be VM minus V gamma. So this voltage, there will be a spike that will appear at this particular instant. And after that, the capacitor will now again charge up to the maximum value VM, so that the output voltage will basically approach to zero. output voltage will now approach to zero. Okay, this will again happen here. This will again happen here, and again it will deviate from its path, and there will be a spike that will appear here. Okay. This is how it's going to look. So let me denote the deviation, or you can say the tilt. This is how much it is deviated. Let's say this is the, this is, let's say this is percentage tilt. Let's say this is delta V naught or tilt. Okay, this is basically referred to as an overshoot, and this is basically your output voltage VO. Let's say this is also your delta V naught or tilt. Okay, so let's do some calculations based on this plot. So due to resistor R, tilt appears in the output waveform. Okay, so tilt, using the law of conservation of charge, tilt will be equal to I discharge into T discharge upon C. This is the same equation that we wrote in when we were discussing about the half wave rectifier and the full wave rectifier with the capacitor filter. So how we basically derived the ripple voltage, that's the same process, that's the same equation. Okay, law of conservation of charge. So tilt will be equal to I discharge into T discharge upon C, where I discharge is equal to 2 Vm by R approximately. This is what you have to use. And percentage tilt is nothing but delta VO by 2 Vm. Okay, this is your percentage tilt into 100%. That's going to be percentage tilt. Let's have a look at an example based on this concept. Let's have a look at this particular example. In the circuit shown, diode is ideal and the input is plus minus 12 volt square wave signal of frequency 1 kilohertz. Calculate the percentage tilt in the output and draw the output waveform. Okay, so let's find out the I discharge. I discharge will be equal to 2 Vm by R. Okay, so 2 into plus 10 divided by R is 50k. Okay, this will be equal to 0.4 milliampere. T is equal to 1 by F naught. T will be equal to 1 by F naught. This will be equal to 1 millisecond. Okay, so T discharge is equal to T naught by 2. Okay, this will be equal to 0.5 millisecond. Now tilt, what will be your tilt? Is I discharge, which is 0.4 milli, into T discharge is 0.5 milli upon capacitor value, which is 1 micro, and this comes out to be 0.2 volt. So percentage tilt will be equal to delta V by 2 Vm into 100%. This will be equal to 0.2 divided by 20 into 100%. And this comes out to be 1%. There will be a 1% per percent tilt. This is your answer. Okay. Okay. Now we just discussed about the negative clamper or the positive peak clamper. The second that we are going to discuss about is the positive clamper or the negative peak clamper. Positive clamper, or you can say a negative peak clamper. Negative peak clamper. Keenly observe the orientation of the diode connected in the circuit. So let's draw the circuit diagram. It's going to look something like this. This is a capacitor C. Now, in the last topic, the orientation was such that the P side was on the upper side and the negative N side was on the downside. So it's going to be reversed in the positive clamper. This is VI, this is a diode, and the output voltage is taken across it. This is VO. Okay, this is the capacitor C. Now, when VI is positive, when VI for the positive half cycle, your diode D will be reverse biased, and for the negative half cycle, your diode D will be forward biased. So the capacitor will charge in this direction. So for the negative half cycle, diode is forward biased and capacitor charges to minus Vm, which means that this is basically your plus Vc. So the capacitor will basically charge through this. So output voltage will be equal to, let's say this is plus, this is Vc. So Vo will be equal to Vi minus Vc. So as you can see, when it is for the negative half cycle, when this is the case, okay, minus plus Vm. When Vi is basically for the negative half cycle, it's minus Vm. Is going to be minus plus Vm and plus Vc. So output voltage will be equal to Vi minus Vc. Okay. So if you apply the KVL in this case, you get Vc as plus Vm. I'm talking about this Vc, minus plus Vc. This is charged with a maximum value of plus Vm. Your output voltage will be equal to Vi. Your output voltage will be equal to Vi minus Vc. So Vo output will be equal to, okay, so this will be equal to Vm, okay, minus plus Vm. So if we apply the KVL in this loop, you get minus Vi minus Vm plus Vo is equal to 0, and Vo will be equal to Vi plus Vm. Vo will be equal to Vi plus Vm. Now when Vi is basically plus Vm, your output voltage will be equal to Vm plus Vm is equal to 2 Vm, and when Vi is basically minus Vm, your output voltage will be equal to minus Vm plus Vm is equal to 0 volt. So if the input waveform is something like this, this is Vi and this T. If the input waveform is something like this, your output waveform, the corresponding output waveform, will look something like this. So this is let's say plus minus Vm. This is minus Vm. Your output waveform would look something like this. This is your output waveform. This is how your output waveform going to look like. Okay. So this is basically your output waveform in under the steady state. Okay. So this is basically your VI. Okay, folks, I am stopping this lecture here. We shall discuss more about the positive clamper or the negative P clamper in the next lecture. Till then, please go through all the lectures before, if you haven't gone through, and try to understand each and every part that I covered in detail in an elucidatory manner, so that it is more clear to you and you won't face any problem while solving questions. Thank you very much. And if you have any doubt, please write down in the comment section below. We will help you out with those. Thank you very much.